The world population has just reached 6.8 billion people. But out of all of those 6.8 billion people, there's only 2 billion of them connected to the internet currently. And that means 70% of the world's population is connecting or yet to connect, coming online very, very rapidly. And if you look at this chart here, you can actually see around the globe, the majority of the internet penetration is still taking place in America and Europe. If you look at Latin America, Asia, Asia's only got 20% internet penetration. If you look at Africa, only 1 in 10 people currently has an internet connection. That's just amazing if you think about that compared to the kind of stuff that we're used to here in Australia. But at the same time, over that period from 2000 to 2010, the world average rate of internet growth is 445%. And relative to here us in Australia, we're only at 179% over that 10-year period. But if you again look at Latin America, if you look at the Middle East, 1,800% internet growth in that 10-year period. If you look at Africa, 2,357% growth. They're coming online so rapidly in double and triple digit rates. And that other 5 billion of people on the planet are on an average wage of $10 or less per day, and that means that they're highly skilled, highly motivated, and hungry for work. At the same time as that 5 billion people are connecting and getting online, every industry is rapidly digitizing. Think for a moment about the impact that Apple has had on the audio and multimedia industry. Think about the way that we now regularly, without even thinking about it, consume music and movie content. With iTunes, the iPhone, the iPad, they've completely revolutionized, totally disrupted that marketplace, and all through the power of a digital file. Think about what Amazon's been able to achieve. Initially, just with an online store, making it so much easier to purchase and get content and publish books shipped out to you. But then the next level beyond that was the Kindle. Now I can not just take my whole bookshelf, but I can take a whole library, put it onto a single device, and again, that comes down to a single digital file. If you're talking about graphic design, we're talking about Photoshop. If you're talking about getting architectural diagrams done for your house, if you're thinking about manufacturing components, we're talking about AutoCAD. And what does that mean for your industry? That means your industry, if it hasn't digitized yet, is about to. So we sit in the middle between businesses and entrepreneurs and that massive pool of global labor, all of those people who are out there, skilled, motivated, and looking to work. We provide that marketplace, that gateway, to put you in touch with them so that your business can really stay focused on what's critical to it and outsource those components that you either don't have the skills for, don't have the staff for, or just don't want to have to worry about. It's all about empowering those entrepreneurs, giving extra opportunities to business so that they can do what they really need to do best and focus on their own growth. We provide a productivity tool, and that productivity tool lets people who have that moment of inspiration take it from just a concept and turn it into a reality. You could be on the train on the way home with your iPad, you could be in an airport lounge with a laptop, it can be 2 a.m, you can be sitting on the couch in your underwear at home, unable to sleep, and you've had that moment of revelation and you say, why has nobody ever done this before? Maybe you've just come up with the next Kindle, maybe you've just come up with the next iPhone, but if you don't have the resources or you don't have the skills or you don't have the time to invest into making that a reality, then the opportunity just slips through your hands. But now what you can do is you can be sitting there, you can pull out your laptop, you can get a logo designed, a website built, an e-store put up, you can get it all hosted on EC2, and you can do it all at a tenth of the cost in half the time. And your concept in your spare time can go from concept to reality so much more quickly than it's ever been possible before. Thomas Friedman, a New York Times journalist and a Pulitzer Prize winner, was quoted as saying this last year, "If I have just the spark of an idea now, I can get a designer in Taiwan to design it. I can get a factory in China to produce and prototype it. I can get a factory in Vietnam to mass manufacture it. I can use Amazon.com to handle fulfillment." And we heard about that earlier today. "I can use Freelancer.com to find someone to do my logo and manage my backroom. And I can do all this at incredibly low prices. The one thing that is not a commodity and never will be is that spark of an idea." So a little bit about Freelancer ourselves. So we started in 2004, and today we are actually the world's largest outsourcing marketplace with over 2.6 million users worldwide, represented in over 234 countries and regions. And that means almost a million posted projects to date, representing over $95 million worth of funds spent through our site to get work done. But at the same time, if you think about what I've been telling you, if you can get work done at a tenth of the price, that really represents more than a half a billion to $1 billion worth of money that's been saved. And that money is being reinvested back into those same businesses to keep that growth going, to accelerate growth, to tackle new challenges and take on new ways of doing business and reaching out into new markets. And because of the success and the traction that we've been able to achieve with these simple concepts, we're now one of the top 250 websites globally. We were a different sort of beast to the one that we are today. When we started out, we had a fully physical, dedicated infrastructure, but we also had a vision for where we wanted to go. We knew at that time, 2 years ago, that we wanted to be the largest outsourcing marketplace in the world, but to get there, we were going to have to move very, very quickly. We were going to have to be innovative, and we were going to have to do it in a way that meant that we could scale up at the drop of a hat. And for us, we knew, starting out at that point, that that had to mean cloud computing for us, because we had all these standard experiences with racking infrastructure and dying disks, and we knew that to be able to actually move forward and really focus down on the thing that was critical to us, we had to outsource that. We had to be able to offload all of that additional work that we knew wasn't core to what we were trying to achieve. And at the same time, we also recognized a certain symmetry, a balance between what we're about and our mission and what cloud computing is all about. Cloud computing is all about taking that hardware, that infrastructure, and taking it away, abstracting it away from what you do day to day. In the same way that for us, it's all about providing that extra labor, those additional resources, those extra skills that you don't currently have on staff or that you don't have on tap. And for us, that just really felt like two sides of the same coin. And if that's the way that, you know, we see ourselves, then cloud computing was going to be a great fit for us as well. At the same time, it was also about focusing on our strengths. We're quite a technical company. We do a lot of our own software development. We're very talented and skilled at handling databases and scaling infrastructure. But at the same time, we wanted to be able to focus on that. We didn't want to have to worry about that hardware component. We really felt that that was something that just wasn't critical to our business. And as a result, we were more than happy to move ahead. And at the same time, looking around, back then, it was certainly a younger marketplace, and Amazon definitely had the most mature product available to us. At the same time, they're also a very engaged technical player. We'd read all the articles on Dynamo, we'd seen what had been achieved with S3, high reliability, high availability storage, and we also knew that Amazon was using its own technology. And there's a certain confidence that you can only get from somebody who's heading in that same direction as you are. Amazon was out there pushing EC2, but using it themselves, pushing S3 and developing and innovating on that platform, but also using it themselves. And for us, that was a clincher. When you can work with a partner that's heading in the same direction as you are, you absolutely jump on board. The final one's a bit more of a technical point, but one that I'm really fond of, because I think the ability to treat infrastructure as an application is a really powerful concept. What you want to be able to do is not just take away that hardware component, but still be able to direct and create what you're doing in that space. And for us, the ability to spin up instances through a function call, the ability to launch databases, create additional storage, attach it to hosts, deploy new static IP addresses, all by writing scripting and code, or as simply as interacting with a web interface, is just a fantastic feature. Since we've begun, we've continued and grown, and as Amazon have launched and integrated new services, we've continued to adopt those that really have fitted well into our current infrastructure and the way that we develop our model. And you can see here that to date we're using EC2 for our instance deployments, S3 for back-end storage, and we actually use that in a couple of ways. We have a marketplace, free market, that we use in terms of back-end object storage, and we store all of our objects there. We also have CloudFront to sit in front of that as a CDN. We have EBS, obviously, as our persistent storage for our instances, and IAM. And for us, IAM was a fantastic piece of development, because it really means that when our application's running, we can make sure that that application can only access exactly the things that we want it to. And that level of control, again, given to the user, in this case, given to us, is a really amazing opportunity to make sure that you're engaging at every level of the stack, at every level of your business. And we were able to do all of this straight off the back of a credit card. This is actually a concept, a slide, and I'm sure that Amazon would prefer you use your own. But for us, this is a slide we also use, because again, there's just a perfect symmetry between us and Amazon. With Amazon, you're able to just walk up one day, lay down a card, and start deploying instances minutes later. You can be spawning terabytes of storage, loading up thousands of objects into S3, and you can all do it all without having to worry about a contract. And like I was saying earlier, we had that experience of dedicated infrastructure. You start out with a contract, you wrestle back and forth about numbers, finally you sign something, fax it back and forth and wait for it to finish up. Then if they've got hardware, then you start arranging a deployment window where they go and rack it for you. Then once it's racked, you've got to start the installation process, and I get tired even just talking about it. What I really wanted was something that got out of the way, but let me really start working straight away. And for us, it's exactly the same way, because you can come along, put down a credit card, and have a project listed within 5 minutes. That's just a really perfect sort of match for us, again, in terms of how we can do business. Because for us, it keeps that flexibility and it keeps us moving quickly. In fact, it works so well, it actually works for the users of our website, because we regularly get Amazon Web Services work outsourced through our marketplace. You can see here, somebody's getting a web application linked to S3 as backend object storage. This person's getting an online e-store linked and pushed up into EC2. And this person's getting a new Rails app deployed onto EC2. And that also means for us that that works well with our development model, because for us, it's all about moving really, really quickly. We want to make sure that we execute fast and we execute often. So it's all about response. We can watch our metrics, see when load's going up, we can see more queries on the database, we need an extra web server, and we can respond in a really timely manner so that we're able to take every opportunity as it comes to us. And at the same time, that fast iteration of try something and experiment and then deploy, and making sure that we can keep that rolling so that we're always focusing on getting those features out, getting that marketplace growing and keeping it growing. Our standard technology stack is very open source based, and again, EC2 is fantastic for this because you've got so many options in terms of your deployments. You can run Linux, you can run OpenSolaris, you can run Oracle as you've heard earlier today. At the same time, you can use all these open source software and it works very, very well. So Linux is our standard operating system platform, PHP is our language, Nginx, Varnish, Memcached, Redis, MySQL, all runs perfectly on top of this EC2 platform. And this is our standard network architecture. So again, what we were able to do is take a classical three-tier architecture and drop it straight onto EC2. Very small modifications to make that happen, but it's very much the same architecture that most web applications use today. And in fact, we actually use a secondary cloud for our staging area. So again, we're able to take all of this, we can snapshot our EBSs for our databases, deploy them into the staging cloud, and then actually operate on our effectively live data, which gives us all kinds of additional benefits in terms of being able to work and make sure that our scale continues to match. A few quick statistics about us. We have between 10 and 15,000 users on the site at any time. We run over 80 instances, a mix of high CPU and high memory instance types, over 15 terabytes of EBS storage, 450 gigs of S3 storage, mostly in 20 to 40K files for our marketplace and our crowdsourcing solution. Our databases handle over 310 million queries per day, total of 600 and almost 80 gig of returned results set data per day, and over 29 million HTTP requests. And for us, that means that we're able to scale and scale up very, very rapidly. And we've been able to do that because Amazon's been growing so rapidly with us and innovating at the same time as we are. And so next for us is to continue that experience of scaling up and scaling out. We're also really excited about some of the new geographic locations that are available to us, especially in terms of content caching delivery. And this is one that's really interesting to me, Route 53. So as I've been saying, outsourcing hardware is absolutely fantastic for us because it takes away something that is absolutely critical, but we also don't want to have to specialize in. And DNS is another really interesting example of that. DNS is a critical piece of technology, but at the same time, not necessarily one that we have to own and run ourselves. We're more than happy to be exploring this technology at the moment because, again, it lets us focus down on the things that are critical to us and outsource the rest. With the enormous potential that cloud computing is bringing to the table in terms of better and more powerful computing power and also offloading all of those extra things that you shouldn't have to worry about. And when you hear that there is an army of freelancers out there waiting to do that work for you at a tenth of the price, in half the time that you would have got it done previously, there's only one thing left to ask, and that's, what are you waiting for?